Welcome to the session. Today we will take up this applications part of it, part 2. I'll discuss about the transistors and amplifiers. Last class we discussed about rectifiers, filters, etc. I explained about Zener diode, photodiodes, etc. Today we'll go for the further part, and then next sessions we'll go for power electronics. So before starting the session, please understand that being an interactive session, actually I request your active participation. The moderator will mute your mics, so that and there will be no disturbance from the outside sounds. Whenever you want to speak, please unmute your mic. At the bottom left hand side, you will have that tab available there. You can unmute. If you are unable to ask any question due to some your network problem or something, please enter your question in the chat box provided in the orange color box with a question mark at the end, so that the moderator can understand, and then moderator can put me the question for answering. Any technical issues, please inform us, so that whatever it is possible, we'll solve the issues. Always insert the question mark at the end of your question to enable the moderator to understand that it is a question. And at the end, don't fail to give a feedback at efeedback@hmdmarine.com. We shall enter into the session now. The learning objectives of this session are, at the end of the session, the participants will be familiarized with transistors and their functions. Transistor usage as an amplifier. We'll discuss about feedback amplifiers, which are normally used in your control systems. Operational amplifier, that's nowadays what you are using it in the form of ICs, what we say integrated chips, etc. And these operational amplifiers are very tiny capsules incorporating a little larger circuit. So majority of the controllers, what we are having on board the ship, the internal part, the controller part or the amplifier part is very, very small, tiny, with that like some small rectangle like a chocolate. It contains major circuits also in that it controls. We call them as operational amplifiers. And then time permits, we'll see transistors used as an oscillator. Oscillator means it can produce AC waveforms, sine waves. Need not be sine waves, anything which is having a frequency. A DC can be converted into AC by having the oscillations, a waveform production, frequency depending upon the design. If it is a time is not permitting, then this can be postponed next class. Diodes. Last class, what we saw was a two-element semiconductor doped with p-n and n-type. But transistor is a three-element doped with p-n n-type impurities. Doping, I told you also, it is addition of the impurities to enable that semiconductor to conduct. Biasing is required for emission of the electrons, called field emission. The three elements of the transistor are known as emitter, base, and collector. Just a dictionary meaning. Emitter, which can emit electrons. That means the emitter has to be very heavily doped. The amount of impurities added or should be a little high Base is just a guiding path, like correct is what is going to receive those electrons emitted by the emitter, thereby closing the circuit, current can flow. I hope I'm audible to all of you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So that collector receives electrons. Basic thing. You just recall what we taught last week. Emitter has to emit electrons. So this junction, emitter-based junction, has to be always forward biased. Conduction. Collector base to be reverse biased so that it can receive the electrons. Here we have got two types of configuration. One is called a PNP type, another is called NPN type, depending upon the doping or whatever you are doing it. Impurity is added. The transistors are further classified as bipolar junction transistors. It's not arc, it is and field effect transistors. What we are going to discuss today is the bipolar junction transistors. Field effect transistors I will discuss in the power electronics topic. There's a small difference that I'll repeat again on that class also. In bipolar junction transistors, we have emitter-based collector. In field effect transistors, we have got source, gate, and drain. It's a basic difference. The power electronics, it can handle large amount of currents compared to bipolar junction transistors. These are all for small current applications. This is a normal configuration for a PNP transistor. The semiconductor is doped like this. On the left side, you got the emitter. Right side, you got collector. It is PNP. So when you want this to conduct, it has to be forward biased. The positive of the battery has to be connected to the P. Negative is connected to the base junction. So that the electrons will start, the holes will start transferring. I don't want to go to too much of theory part of it. The flow starts taking place. Forward bias conduction starts. Collector has to collect the electrons. So it has to be reverse biased. So negative will go here and become here. This is how the circuit is getting completed. Emitter base forward biased for conduction. Collector base reverse biased for receiving the electron, thereby circuit is completed. Current starts flowing. So in the NPN configuration, what you are seeing here, emitter has to be forward biased. So you must connect negative of the battery here. Positive will go here. Collector base has to be reverse biased. Collector is N, negative type. So actually you have to put connect the positive terminal of the battery here. This is the only difference between NPN and PNP. So the basic mantra is that emitter base is always forward biased. Collector base is always reverse biased. When you are referring the textbooks, the arrow mark given for the current direction, etc., it may confuse you. Avoid confusion. Always remember, emitter emits electrons. collector receives electrons. The arrow mark of PNP will be different, NPN will be different. That should not mind bog you, because this is only an understanding you must have. Emitter emits electrons, collector receives electrons. Those directions are given for further circuit analysis. We are not going to give too much of circuit analysis here. We are just studying the practical applications of it, plus something required for the examination purposes. So symbolically, it is represented this way, PNP and NPN. The difference you see, the arrow mark. When arrow mark is pointing towards the base, it is a PNP configuration. When arrow mark is away from the base, it is called a NPN configuration. We can use any one, either a PNP configuration or a NPN configuration. But majority of the circuit diagrams, what shown in textbooks, etc., they'll be of NPN configuration. Don't come to a conclusion it has got a very large advantage or anything like that. Both are having almost similar advantages. The semiconductor material, what I'm using, it is having that property requirement, either silicon or germanium. Majority of the people, they use silicon for the applications part of it. Again, the same configuration, because we've got a three legs here. I have a three possible modes of applications. One is called a common base connection, base remaining constant, the connection between emitter and collector. Another one is called a common emitter connection, where the input is given between base and emitter, output is taken between collector and emitter. In common base mode, input is between emitter and base, output is between base and collector. That I'll show you by diagram. And common collector is also available, but to my knowledge, on board the applications, practical applications, you don't use the common collector. It may be for some design, experimental, or laboratory requirement. But on board the ship, we normally go for common emitter mode connections. Most of the amplifiers, they have got this common emitter mode. So transistor can, it's a semiconductor, can conduct and insulate. Normally, it can act as a switch also, or it can amplify the signals, depending upon what application you want to apply for. Wherever you are using as an audio amplifier, just like your speakers, sometimes you are hearing your audio output. Any doubts, please? Any audio output, etc. Normally, amplifier can convert these audio waves into sound waves, into electronic waves. A resistor is always placed in a circuit to control the flow of current. As long as we are operating within that safe limit of temperature, transistors have their good life. Remember, when temperature crosses a particular limit, depending upon the design, as I told you in the last two classes, thermionic emission also will start taking place, thereby avalanche breakdown will take place. So naturally, all these semiconductor equipments or electronic equipments can be operated, or should be operated, in a controlled temperature. Wherever current carried is more, we have something called a heat sink to enable the heat dissipation to make the equipment operate in a satisfactory condition. One more point, I hope I'm not going to confuse you, but one more point you should remain in your mind. Whichever equipment operating for a little longer time under some temperature condition, maybe a safe temperature, over a period of time, the properties will change. Never try to adjust the settings in any electronic circuit without consulting the manufacturer. If you alter the setting or whatever it is preset, to get back to the original setting, it is very, very difficult because the temperature would have made the properties change. You may feel I have done within the mentioned temperature, yes, but even then, the temperature will create that particular havoc. So this is called a common base mode. Just here, hope you'll be able to see my pen pointer here. This is the base, this is the emitter, and this is the collector. So it is NPN mode, arrow mark away from the base. So it is forward biased by giving a negative supply. And then the current starts flowing. And we call this as an input side. And this is the output side. Sorry for my handwriting. So PNP also, you just see here. This should be a positive. This is a signal is given, but this is ignored. Biasing is positive. Forward bias. Collector is reverse bias. You see the negative point connected here. So IE, what is shown here, is the input current. IC is the output current. Again, I request you, do not bother about these arrow marks. Purpose of collector is to receive electrons. The current will flow into the collector. Emitter will emit electrons. So you see here, this is a base. PNP, you can just interchange with that rectangle or whatever you want to have. So this, we normally we represent this particular potential here as VEB. When you are studying circuit, always the positive point is mentioned in the first letter, and the negative point will come. Similar way here, it will be VBC. Just to show you how it is represented in the books. So this is called a common base circuit. Again, it is not used for the practical applications, because what you say, the gain is less than one. In electrical machines and other things, we talk about efficiency as output by input. In transistor circuits, we call it as a gain, GAIN. So gain is nothing but output current by input current. In this case, IC by IE. Another thing always you must remember is that emitter is emitting the electrons. So IE is the main current. It will be equal to the base current plus collector current. The another thing you must remember, IE is equal to IB plus IC. What will be the mode of operation? Common base, common emitter, or a common collector? IE is always equal to IB plus IC, or emitter current is base current plus collector current. Anybody wants to make a note of it, you can make a note of those who are going for exam. This is a basic thing. Emitter emits collector electrons, collector receives electrons, so IE is equal to IB plus IC. So in this common base connection, IE is input current, IC is output current. common emitter mode, it will be base will be the input current, IB will be the input current, and collector IC will be the output current. So as I told you, efficiency is represented as a gain, output current by input current. So in common bias mode, we say gain as alpha. It is given by a formula called collector current by emitter current. In common emitter mode, the gain is given as a beta, collector current to base current. In common collector mode, the gain is given as gamma, emitter current to base current. Base current to emitter current. Base is input current and emitter will be the output current. But common collector, we are not using it practically, so we are not discussing, but next slide I've given the definition, but we normally use common emitter mode because the gain beta is always greater than 1. We are going to use it as an amplifier. Amplifier means increasing the magnitude or value of the output, magnifying. But common base mode, it is less than 1, so normally we don't go for it. But common emitter mode, since output is quite high, we go for the common emitter mode. So common collector mode, it is gain is always 1 plus beta, but still we don't use this here. The normal thing, we use only for special purposes, some analysis, laboratory analysis circuits. So this is that amplifier circuit called a common emitter circuit. Here there may be some confusion for the people. I don't mind explaining once or twice here to understand this. Now all these components are come into a small chip, maybe by about 20 mm by 20 mm square. This is using an NPN silicon transistor. You see the arrow mark is away from the base, so it's called NPN transistor. It is used in the common emitter mode. Emitter is common and it is grounded. Input is given between the base and the emitter. Output is taken between the collector and the emitter. What is the basic requirement? Biasing is required. Now, this particular area, it forms a transistor operational circuit. VCC is the source supply. It can be 24 volts, it can be 12 volts, it can be 30 volts, whatever it is available. From the common supply, I am tapping for giving to bias by means of something called a voltage divider. The basic electricity classes, I have told you, series circuit, we use it as a voltage divider. Parallel circuits, we use it as a current divider. In parallel circuit, voltage remains constant. In series circuit, current remains constant. So this biasing is given, NPN transistor, collector will have a positive supply, emitter will have a negative, collector, emitter has to be reverse biased, NPN. So this voltage is dropped through the R1 resistor, R1, R2 combination, and it is given here. So that voltage is marked here as a VB, or we can say it is a VBE. What will be the voltage here? VCC minus this current into R1, voltage drop. That is the voltage drop here. VCC minus current into R1. That voltage drop, and the balance is available here. That is coming as a bias. We must ensure that this voltage between base and emitter is more than that 0.7 or whatever it is required, so that a transistor can conduct. If you want to know what is the base current, nothing but VB by R2 will be the base current. Don't mind walk yourself for memorizing or something like that. As per Ohm's law, voltage based resistance is a current. Now I have given the bias. Please remember, this is a purely a DC circuit. All these components I'll explain you a little later. This R1, R2 forms the bias circuit. Now I want to amplify a signal. I am giving an AC signal. Let us say I am giving an AC signal. So the current will start flowing here. Already there is a bias given. On top, the signal current also will come. When this is on the rising mode, the waveform is on the rising mode, IB will increase. IC is output current. IC also will increase. By what value? By beta, the gain. As I told you, always there is a resistance in the output circuit for taking the output. In any electronic circuit, a load resistor is given for taking the output. If I say VCE is output, VCE is nothing but VCC minus IC into RL. So the waveform, when it is going on increasing, the current will start increasing. Here also the voltage drop will start increasing. When it is going towards the negative direction, or when current is reducing that slanting path, IB will reduce, IC also will reduce, but the voltage drop also will reduce, then the waveform output will change. How it is changing, what is changing, I'll show you in the next slide. So this is the bias circuit. I am giving that bias to the transistor by means of the voltage divider. So IB is input current, and the gain is beta, IC by IB. Remember, biasing is by DC. The input signal can be anything. Here I've shown you what is called an AC input. So during that rising part of the waveform, IB increases, IC also increases, collector current also increases by beta into the input current. Hence, the voltage drop across the resistor increases. Correspondingly, the output decreases. This is a waveform. I have given an AC waveform. output looks as though decreasing, but actually the waveform is going in a negative direction. Actually, there's a phase reversal. I'll show you the waveform. Same way, when that waveform is changing towards the negative side, when IB decreases, IC is also decreasing. The voltage drop also will decrease. Output start increasing. The waveform starts going in the upper direction. So hence, if the AC input is sinusoidal waveform, output is also sinusoidal waveform, but the phase reversal takes place by 180 degrees. This is how the waveform. I am giving the input here like this. It is a magnified or amplified output. Then input is rising, output is reducing or going in the negative direction. Then the input is reducing here, output starts rising, and vice versa. So kindly make a note. Is the input signal given? Output has got a phase reversal by 180 degrees. Even though in theory I write the output decreases, it's not decreasing. The waveform changes the direction. The value is magnified. See, you see the value here. It is the amplified value. How much? The value is beta. So I'll erase this to try to explain you something. So input, whatever I'm giving, output is going to be reversed. Suppose input is like this, output will be like this. This particular portion, I told you it is DC. This particular portion is DC. In this DC, I am giving an AC supply, what we call superimposing. The word is confusing you, just leave it like that. On top of the DC, I am sending the AC inside. Output, what I want is pure AC. So all the DC components has to be kept within this. Input also may have some stray DC currents or whatever it is. I don't want that to obstruct my bias circuit. So we use a capacitor. For filtering out DC. When I was discussing about the filter circuits in the diode, I told you that the capacitor allows AC, looks as though it's allowing AC because it charges and discharges AC. DC means just remains charged. DC never passes. But AC charges, discharges, charges, discharges. So it looks as though AC is passing the capacitor. So when I give the input, all the stray DC fields will be stopped by this capacitor. So this is called as the input capacitor for filtering out the stray DCs. Similar way, on the output side, I must have a capacitor here. Not shown in the drawing, but it has to have a capacitor here called output capacitor. So that the DC components here, whatever got mixed up within the bias circuit, whatever the DC component got mixed up, will not pass out. I'll have only AC. Suppose this waveform is reversed. I want to further bring it back to the original shape. I can add one more amplifier like this. That time this becomes the input capacitor, the other one will have the output capacitor separate. So here also, again, if you see here, I put one more capacitor here. This is called a emitter bypass. Anybody going for exam, you can make a note. It's called emitter bypass. So whatever the AC and DC got mixed up, the AC will be bypassed. This transistor circuit will have only DC, nothing else will be there. So output is between collector and emitter. Whatever the AC stray AC or whatever the AC is carried here, that can be bypassed to the ground through this capacitor. So this transistor circuit will have only pure DC. We saw this three important components which we have to understand in amplifier. One is called input capacitor to bypass the stray DCs. Another is output capacitor to allow only AC part DC is filtered. The third is a emitter bypass, which removes all the AC components in the transistor circuit. So this is the basic thing what you must understand in the amplifier. Just an example I given, but I don't want to go through different connections. It will test your patience. So I'm not going for that. It's a common type of transistor circuit used for amplifiers. Output is VCC minus IC into RL. The same waveform will be like this. So feedback amplifiers. Feedback means on the output, a fraction is taken, sent back to the input for altering or rectifying the condition. For example, error is there. Error can be sensed, can be given back to the input side, compared to the set value, and corrective action is taken. Many other controllers, it is there. So for that, instead of having an open loop control, we have a feedback control. The feedback is always taken from the output going towards the input. So naturally, that feedback will reduce or distortions or any vibrations or any fluctuations. And after a small amount of time, depending upon the characteristics of the circuit, we may have a steady state output or the required output. So we have got two types of feedbacks. One is called a positive feedback. Another is called a negative feedback. Negative feedback maintains or sustains the amplification. Positive feedback, it leads to oscillations. Meaning, I'm going on giving extra, going on getting, adding up, the value will be going on increasing. Whereas negative feedback will have a controlling action. So output can be made to a constant value. So most of the controller circuits, we will have this negative feedback. Let it be a boiler combustion control, feed water control, whatever it is. They will have some output is sensed. Any error is there, error is rectified. But in oscillators where deliberately I want to create that waveforms, same amplifier, I give a positive feedback. That is only deliberately when it is required. Otherwise, normally we have that negative feedback amplifiers. This is how that schematically it is shown. Portion of the output is taken through the feedback circuit and connected to the input side. depending upon how the connection is made, this is classified as a positive feedback or negative feedback. For example, suppose this is positive and this is negative. Suppose this is positive and this is negative, this becomes a negative feedback. Suppose this becomes negative, this becomes positive, this becomes a positive feedback. How much is the feedback to be given? That depending upon the design factor, whatever it has been designed, a fraction what we say. Again, I'm not going to go into too much of theory because it will be unnecessarily straining you. Actually, the symbol is for an operation amplifier, but this is normally given. You see, the output is given as a feedback. When this is positive and given to positive, it's called a positive feedback. You see here the waveforms, both are additive, both are additive. This is the main input, this is a feedback input. Here the both are subtractive or both are in the opposite direction. So this will be used for the amplifiers, this will be used for oscillators. So these are all the possibilities of the negative feedback. It reduces the gain, of course, but you can have a standard the gain, a constant output after some time. That's the stability is there. Distortion is reduced. Suppose I want to overcome the disadvantage of the losing the gain, I can use multi-stage amplifiers.
Mr. Jenaka, sir, moderator yes. Here.
Yes, madam.
Polling time, sir. Now we can launch the poll now.
Oh, go ahead, madam. No problem.
Thank you, sir. Dear participants, please give your valuable feedback by polling which appear in your screen. Thank you.
So these are all called operational amplifiers. You'll be surprised to see on the right side, this is the size of the amplifier now. It will have 3-4 stages of amplifiers here. Inside, the component what I showed you as a transistor, it is no more like a transistor component. It is all done by etching, E-T-C-H-I-N-G, etching the tin oxide. Same dabba can have 3-4 amplifier circuits. This is what we are having nowadays. Majority of the controllers, if you open that controller box or something, you will find a black box like this with some numbers written on top, something given here. That is just to identify what type of this thing they have used in the circuit in case replacement is required. All these terminals are identified how the wiring has to be done. It's normally sort of a plug-in type. And this is a schematic diagram. So these, what you are seeing, the 2 points here, they are that bias supply. And this is the input, what you are going to give. There can be two inputs, but output is only one. This is how the numbers are being done for your operational amplifier, that the lugs, etc. This is that identification marks. And this etching mark is given to identify how the circuit has to be assembled, because you must know which is the starting point, which is the ending point. These things will not be printed here. This is given in that beginning of the circuit diagrams book. We identify by this how it is going to be assembled. So when you are removing this thing also, when you are putting back your new IC, it's called the integrated circuit, nothing but an operational amplifier. Remember this particular point. That should be putting going to the same place. While removing, you have to identify this. While fixing also, you must be very careful in fixing up the same. So I can have a single input operational amplifier, or I can have multiple. Multiple inputs will act as a differential amplifier. Difference between two inputs can be compared, and the output can be amplified. The supply point, remember, this is not on generally for the normal biasing circuits. Just to show you how that internally, see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 transistor circuits are assembled within one operational amplifier in this case. So it has got the three stage. It can even have the differential stage also. But all these transistors are assembled inside in the form of a tin oxide etching. Even these components are all etching only. So by chance something goes wrong with the operational amplifier or the IC, only you have to replace it. You can't do any repair inside. They are all just looking like a white lines, small lines drawn by a pen like. So major thing is only a replacement of these amplifiers. If you see here, signal amplitude is always amplified. You see here a transducer. Again, some of the students who attended my earlier class too, they know that the strain gauge is called a pressure transducer. Even though I understand MEC, MEB engines are outlet side for the cylinder pressure or exhaust gas pressure, whatever indication is required, it's all done by your strain gauges. And whatever it is measuring, normally strain gauges are used in four strain gauges arranged in the form of a Wheatstone's bridge. The difference is taken to an amplifier. The variable signal is converted to a digital signal for giving to that central processing unit. From there, the output can be taken either only as a reading as a measurement, or if you want to affect a control, output can be again converted into an analog form and control can be affected. So here we say ADC converter, there we say DAC converter. So the operational amplifiers are used in so many applications, a comparator, voltage follower, signal modulation, even in your AVRs, some of the feed water controllers or combustion controllers. I mean, even any controller, whatever you want to have, majority of these controllers are made of these operational amplifiers only. So another application for transistors is sort of oscillators. They convert the direct current into alternating current. So here what we should do is, normally we give that positive feedback. Again, the frequency of the output can be controlled by selecting your output circuit. The output circuit can be tuned or adjusted for selecting a particular frequency. So we got these type of oscillators which are all used on board ship. And majority will find these oscillators will be a phase shift oscillator or Hartley oscillator or Colpitts and Kissel oscillators. Details will just see the circuit diagram, etc. in the next session. These are all using something called the inductors and capacitors. Phase shift oscillator using a resistance and a capacitor to select the timing or the frequency. Frequency is depending upon the time. If I say that one cycle is completed in 1 second, I say frequency is 1 cycle per second. Second, time factor, 1 second on the x-axis. So in phase shift oscillator, the time is controlled by the combination of R and C. Time constant is RC. In tuned oscillators like Hartley or Colpitts, we use inductance and capacitance. They charge and discharge between themselves. We call this like a tank circuit. I'll explain to you in the next class. And that depending upon the time constant of both inductive and capacitive circuit. Capacitive circuit, you know, it is RC. Inductive circuit is R by L. This is a basic block diagram of an oscillator. It uses an amplifier. Output is taken and given as a positive feedback to make it oscillate. Current is controlled by the output resistor. The oscillation is controlled by the selection of the tuning circuit in the output side, either RC combination or LNC combination. Since time is coming up, I will leave you for the question and answer session. Any question is there, I will answer your questions, please. Any questions? I am ready to answer your questions.
There is no questions in chat, Mr. Janakar, sir. Dear participants, if you're having any doubts, you can unmute yourself and you can ask the doubts to the faculty.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, when you've shown that PNP diagram, actually, third thread or fourth thread.
Okay.
On the collector side, there were three batteries, I think so. Reason for that?
Further? How you want to?
No, that third slide. No, not this one. Well, there were three diagrams.
Here.
Two are of NP. This one.
Okay. See, naturally, emitter is heavily doped. So it is easy to conduct when that voltage is crossing 0.7 volts here. Collector is not that much heavily doped. So it has to receive the electrons. To give that energy, we are giving little more voltage on the collector side. Nothing else. It's only a representation. Emitter needs only something to start emitting because it is having a good quantity of good quantum of electrons. But collector is not that much doped. It is just doped with a very, very small quantity to enable to receive these electrons. To enable it to collect more and more electrons from the emitter, that voltage is slightly shown higher here compared to the input side. Am I clear?
Okay. Thank you.